Hello, beautiful people. What is up? I'm so happy to be here. All right, it's been a little while. It's been a hot minute since we've done a live stream, and some of you, some of our dedicated diehard fans have been saying, what's up? We're not seeing you on the live streams anymore. We're not seeing long form content. I get it. The algorithm wants shorts, and that's why we produce shorts, but we're back with none other than Laura Beauparlant, and we're going to talk to her in a second. In case you don't know who I am, my name is Christo. I'm a loud introvert, and I have this big, hairy, audacious goal, which is to teach a billion people how to make a living doing what they love. Without further ado, Laura, can you introduce yourself, please?
Hey, Chris. Thanks for having me back again. I'm so excited to be here. So I am an entrepreneur. I'm a brand strategist, which we'll have to go back to the last time we chatted because you challenged me on that title. So I'm owning that. I'm a brand strategist. Okay. I'm an author. I'm an international keynote speaker and the founder of Lab Creative.
Ooh, that's a lot of stuff that you do.
It is.
Okay, so before we get into the topic
I should throw that one in there.
So before we get into the topic, I want to ask you one really quick question because you said, I challenged you. I don't even remember the challenge. And remind me what we're talking about.
So I was not calling myself a brand strategist. And I was like, I got really uncomfortable when you said that to me. And I was like, ooh, okay. I feel like I can't call myself that. And so that was a really interesting conversation. And so I spent a lot of time really diving into that. And it was that imposter syndrome that was cropping up for me. And now I proudly call myself a brand strategist. So thank you.
Love it, love it, love it. Yeah. Okay. Through the miracles of modern technology, Jonah, myself, and you are in three different places. I'm on the West Coast of the United States, and you're on the East Coast of Canada. You're in Toronto. I'm here in Santa Monica. But we're going to make this thing happen. I say that just in case there are some technical glitches. We both have children in the house who sometimes siphon off our internet connection, but everybody's been told, chill out just for a little while so we can have this conversation, right?
Exactly.
Okay. So what are we talking about today, Laura?
Today we're talking about authenticity and vulnerability.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Okay. Anything in
Hot
particular?
Topics.
Yes.
Well, you know, sure. I want to really challenge some thinking. I want people to, you know, think about, have you ever struggled to figure out how vulnerable to be in my business? How much of me should I share? Are you actually confused about what is authenticity and what is vulnerability? Does it just mean crying on camera for people? Or have you found yourself being triggered by a traumatic story that somebody is sharing on their social channels? So I really want to dive into this topic and help entrepreneurs really understand how to leverage authenticity and vulnerability and maintain a personal life.
Okay. It's very interesting that we're even using the word authenticity because it implies then, are you sometimes being inauthentic? Are you being disingenuous? And I just want to start off there, maybe just turn up the heat a little bit. Are people not appearing online as themselves?
I think they are hiding parts of themselves and they're sharing things that they feel they should be sharing all in the name of vulnerability and authenticity. And I think we don't have to show our, you know, rolled out of bed self or hot mess self. You know, you can still show up and, you know, be your best self and curate the stories that you want to share that will help your business, that will help your audience and maintain a private life for yourself. I believe that just because something is happening in your life doesn't mean you need to share that with the world. And so it's not about being secretive. It's about really showing who you are and your whole self and your personality so people get to know you. And it doesn't mean you have to share every single detail of your life in a play-by-play online.
Okay, then that begs the question because I'm with you. I'm totally with you in that there are some things that need to just be private because you're working through them or it's of no interest to anybody else. It's kind of, this is my private stuff that I'm going through. And then there's, let's go to the polar extreme where people are living highly curated lives and they only talk about the good things. They only talk about their successes or when they're winning a client or overcoming some challenge. And then we create this false expectation that everyone looks this good, is this fit, and is always winning all the time. and it's led to some unhealthy behaviors and even depression for some younger people. So how do we know where we are in that line in the spectrum?
Such a good question. And it's not about curating only the good stories. It's about finding the difficult stories to share, but not having to share them in the moment. So I heard a saying years ago that was, teach from your scars, not from your wounds. And that's how I was like, oh, this all makes so much more sense to me now, because this was how I'd been living my life. And, you know, it's really looking at, is what I'm about to share something that's a gaping wound? Or is it something that's healed that I can share? It may still be difficult to share the story because it was something that you feel maybe shame around, or, you know, that doesn't put you in the best light, but you're sharing it on the other side of that event. When you're sharing in the moment, you're getting sympathy, and you could be re-traumatizing other people who've experienced something similar. And then it creates that victim mentality and that victimhood. It's not always about, hey, I did this and I overcame it and look at me, I'm doing amazing. It's also about sharing those things that didn't work and sharing them from a place of like, this is hard to share. This was a struggle and it didn't turn out the way I wanted. And whatever you learned from that experience and sharing that with your audience so that they see you as a whole person. I think that's what sharing these stories allows us to do, is to humanize us in our businesses, in our brands, so that people really can see who we are. But it doesn't mean you need to lay your soul bare for the world to see, because you can't take that back, right? Whatever we put out there into the world is out there, and it can really damage the perception people have of you in the work that you do, whether you are a business owner, an entrepreneur, you are an employee somewhere. It can affect your ability to continue to do what you love to do if you're always sharing those traumatic or challenging things in the moment.
Wonderful. I love that high level overview and this kind of very descriptive thing that you're talking about. I work best with examples. So how can we use you or me as an example of someone who is going to be open, to be authentic, and to be vulnerable? Or can you share some things that are not just the positive things, but some of the things that, you know, those were not my best days, but I'm over that. And maybe we can also talk about who you think in the public eye is doing a really good job of balancing that line of authenticity and vulnerability without necessarily oversharing those fresh wounds that you talked about. So let's start with you first. Tell us something about you so that we can understand what the template might look like.
Yeah. So I'll share a story. A number of years ago, it was 2017. I was just launching Brand Camp online. I was super focused on getting it out into the world, you know, creating video scripts and workbooks and doing all of the things to like build this course and put it out there into the world. And I dropped the ball on lead generation and business dried up. It was ugly. I was like, uh-oh, what have I done? You know, and I didn't go on publicly and share this because I was like, that's not a place to get business when you're desperate. If I was like, oh my God, guys, like, so we have no business. And like, I'm super desperate right now. I'm like, we're dropping our prices so that, you know, we really just need some revenue in so I can pay my bills next month. Like, imagine if I had done that. I didn't. But that's like, I see things like that happening. And so I went through that. I went to my counsel. I went to my friends, my husband, my business coach. I surrounded myself with people who could really support me through that. Even my team, I was very real about what was happening in the business and that I needed their support. And then I just hyper-focused on really going after lead generation and getting on stages and doing all the things that I had dropped the ball on earlier that year. And it took a number of months, but we got through it. We had to ride through some rough months revenue-wise, but we came through on the other side, and I learned so many lessons from that. And then I wrote a blog post about that experience at the end of the year when I'd learned what I needed to learn, and I shared really candidly about this experience. And it was the most commented on, most viewed, the emails I was getting from people just saying, wow, I've never seen you write like this before. And it made me realize I'd probably not been as vulnerable or as authentic previously. And this was me really sharing something that was hard for me to share, to show that I had not been doing as well as, you know, that perception of what people think. And it was a real turning point for me, because I was able to really see the power of sharing that scar with my audience, that, you know, made me feel like, okay, maybe this doesn't put me in the best light, but this is where I am now, and this is what I can share from this experience.
Mm. Did you have to cut any team members or make some drastic financial decisions to ensure that you're going to be able to survive this dry period?
Yep. I had to cut back some time for my designer. I had to have a very candid conversation, say, I don't have any money. I can't pay you right now. Can we cut this back? I even found her some freelance work to help supplement her income, just to kind of help, because I felt responsible. Right. Yeah. And I felt like a failure in that moment, and the thing is, what's interesting now is I go back to that experience. Whenever something happens in my business or life, it's like, nothing is insurmountable. Like, this happens, it happens for a reason. I need to pay attention to what is happening, and sharing those lessons, even if they're not always, you know, like I said, if it doesn't make me feel like this was the best outcome, there may be stories that I'll share that was like, this didn't go well. I had a program I launched this year, I'll share this with you right now, that did not go well. And I did not enjoy it. And I was like, oh, I have to cancel. And I was like, wait a minute, this is my business. And I just stopped offering this program, because it was just not working. And I felt like, oh, I put so much time and effort into this, and it just didn't work. And at the end of the day, I didn't love it. It wasn't mm-hmm. filling me up. And so then I couldn't give the best to my clients. So I pulled the plug on it, something I'd spent hours and thousands of dollars and time and effort into creating, only to kind of backpedal and go, wait a minute, actually, nope, this isn't going to work, and I don't want to do this.
Does sharing these things help you heal? Does it help you in terms of contribute to other people's learning and their knowledge? What is the motivation of sharing these things?
I think that's one of the questions to ask yourself, is why are you sharing the story? Like, what's mm-hmm. the purpose of it? If the purpose of it is to vent and to commiserate and to get sympathy, you know, that's not a really great time to go onto social media. But if you're like, this happened to me, and there's got to be a lot of other entrepreneurs that have experienced this, and I can share the lessons I learned, so hopefully they won't repeat those things. Or it's a story that you're like, I know a lot of people are going through this, and it'll help them relate to me in a better way. Because sometimes people see you and they're like, they put you up on this pedestal, like you're perfect, your business is thriving and doing all these things. And then they hear a story where you were struggling with, you know, with leads, with revenue, with whatever it was. And they're like, oh, it humanizes that person more. It makes you more relatable and more attainable, because sometimes people think, well, I could never have what this person has. They're doing all these amazing things in their business. So when you share these stories, it allows people to relate to you in a more powerful way. And sometimes it's just a really funny story or a personal story that will, again, just help people. It will humanize you and help create those deeper connections, because they see you as more of a whole person rather than mm-hmm. just like a business entity.
Mm-hmm. I have so many things I want to talk to you about this. And I think the reason why I wanted to do this conversation is because so many of our friends who are still, I think, are coming up in the professional circles as a designer, as a brand strategist, or as a marketer, and they're not quite comfortable in telling some of their vulnerabilities and sharing some of their wins and losses together. They're actually quite private. But yet at the same time, simultaneously, they desire to grow a social media following. They want to build an audience, and they want to be where they perceive others are at in terms of like being able to speak on the stage and commanding an audience and being able to tell powerful stories. And so, Laura, yeah. I don't want to reveal your age, but people who watch this channel know that I'm 49 years old. So I look at like, you know, I put in my time. I paid my dues, quote unquote. So I'm okay sharing all this stuff because I'm at a place where I can confidently share things and not worry like my business is going to come to a grinding halt. Are you in that place yourself, Laura, where you can speak and say things and not worry too much? Or are you still in that moment where, yeah, there's some consequences and I have to be careful?
I think I mean, I could be in a deep crisis right now and I wouldn't be sharing it if that were the case because it's too personal, right?
Twice, like, I'm not going to. That's the case. Yeah.
Yeah. No, just kidding. I just don't believe in barfing my personal life all over social media, right? Like, I really, you know, I look at a story and I go, okay, what is my purpose for sharing this story? Right? That's the first question that I want to ask myself. The next one is this the right time to share the story, or is it relevant? And will this story hurt somebody that I'm telling this story about? So I won't go on and share stories about, you know, family or somebody that if I shared the story, it could potentially harm somebody. I'm not going to go on and like rant about my kids or my husband or don't, Philippe, I would never do that. I know you're watching. But, you know, it's really about assessing, is this my story to tell? And is this relevant to my audience? There's a million stories I could tell, but is it my story to tell? Is now the right time? And will this help my business or help my audience? Will people resonate with this? So I've shared a lot, and I don't remember if we talked about this last time, about my car accident that I was in, which is now about 26 years ago. I was in a head-on collision with a drunk driver. And from time to time, I will share a story from that event, from the wound, because it is, or from the scar, sorry, not the wound, because I've healed from it. And when I share the stories, the number of people that respond to that and email me and say, wow, I can now accept my scars in a deeper way than I never have before, or they're inspired by something that I've said and it changes something they're doing in their life. It's not because I'm looking for sympathy. It's not because I'm trying to relive the past or I'm trying to bring that up. It's because to me, I learned so much from that experience and I have so much to share from that could really help a lot of people, whether or not they've experienced a car accident or something really traumatic like that. But I'm not sharing it from a place of trauma.
Yeah. Mm. You mentioned earlier off air and on air that you have a son that I know of and maybe other children, but how old is your son, by the way?
14 and 10. So I have two boys.
Okay, 14 and 10, wonderful. I have two boys, 18 and 15. And I bring this up because you and I, we grew up in a different time in a different generation. Again, I don't want to reveal how old you are. I just talk about myself this way.
I'm slightly younger than you.
Okay, this is good to know. Okay, so I grew up in a time, and it's hard to believe this, pre-Google, pre-internet, and I literally had to ask my older brother, what is the internet? And some of you young people are falling out of your chair because you only know of the world with the internet and smartphones in your pockets, right? There was a time, believe it or not, everyone, that people didn't have phones. Not every single person had a phone in their pocket. Only a few people had that. The reason why I say this is because I represent a whole generation of people before me who didn't grow up with the internet, and this whole idea of social sharing is very foreign. It feels like it's oversharing and it's about revealing too much and we have to be careful. Whereas my two boys, they post all kinds of weird stuff. And I'm thinking, this is probably not what you want to be posting because once it gets on the internet, it's kind of out there forever. But it's a whole different generation. And they tend to not think that there's actually tomorrow and they don't think long term. And I think we're both in the same camp when we say, think, be thoughtful in what you share. Understand the intention of why you share it. Is it to prop yourself up? Is it to put other people down? And in some cases, are you being malicious to badmouth people? Because that's not necessarily a good representation of who you are, your values, and your brand, whether this is done personally or professionally. But there is this Absolutely. Middle ground, right? So there's the middle ground. Now, I want to say a couple of things for people to understand why you would want to share any of this stuff. Now, we know that when we're watching a film or we're reading a book and the character's too perfect, they're usually not the hero in the story. There's usually something wrong with them. There's some psychosis. They're like a Stepford wife and something is wrong. And it turns out that they're robots or something. We just don't know. And we get that sense that when people come across as being too perfect, too nice, too kind, too peppy, that there is something sick and twisted. Maybe it's we're the sick and twisted ones and we're projecting onto them that people can't be that happy and that perfect. And so I just want you to think about that. Number two, well, I want to share with you. Okay.
Go ahead. Right. No, I was just going to say there's a thing around toxic positivity that I think, you know, there is a thing is, you know, oh, just be happy. Like you should be happy because you're not as bad as this person. Or there's a lot of talk about this toxic positivity. And we're seeing so much of that, that people start to feel inadequate in their own lives. Like, oh, should I be happy? And people are downplaying other people's pain. So I think we don't always have to be happy.
Yeah. That's the whole sweep it under the rug or carpet kind of idea, right? Like no matter what trauma, what pain you're going through, depression, people don't want to hear that. So just sweep it under the rug. And I have to say that if you keep doing that, there's going to be a big pile and eventually you're going to trip over it and you're not going to want to do that either. Okay. So some concepts for people to understand, because I do like to talk a lot about personal branding and I think the idea of vulnerability, authenticity really tie into personal branding. Robert McKee, who wrote the book Story, and he's a much sought after Hollywood scriptwriting consultant. He says it this way, stories need conflict. And he goes on to say more emphatically, no conflict, no story. So when you go out there and let's say your intention is to build community and awareness and an audience, and you skip over the conflict, the hard parts in your life, the parts in which you struggled with, then you wind up getting put in this other category again that people see as fake and disingenuous and you can't connect with people. So the fear of sharing some of your vulnerabilities is that you'll drive people away. But in fact, sharing some of your vulnerabilities, some of your struggle is a thing that actually makes you more attractive as a person. There's a story here, Stan Lee. I saw an interview somebody had sent to me via Instagram. He's speaking at USC and he's telling a story about the creation of Spider-Man, right? He goes, when the editor tells you, I need another character, and at that time he was kind of low on the totem pole, he's like, okay, I need to create another superhero. He's like, I already created the Fantastic Four and the X-Men, he thinks. He's like, I need to create another character. So he says, the number one thing you need for all characters is you need to come up with a superpower. All superheroes need a superpower. So he's at home, he's staring at the wall, and he sees a fly crawling on the wall. He goes, wouldn't it be neat if a person could crawl on the wall? He's like, what is this person going to be called? Let's call him Flyman. Now, that didn't sound good. Mosquito Man? No, they're parasites. People don't like that either. So he comes up with this idea. He's like, I know. He's going to be called Spider-Man. So he goes back to the office and he tells his editor, I got the idea for the next character. It's going to be called Spider-Man. And his editor, all wise and all knowing, says to him, Stan, you can't call a character Spider. People have a fear around spiders. And so Stan's like feeling a little down. He's like, oh God, okay. And he goes, tell me a little bit more about this character. And he says, well, you know how like characters like Superman, they don't have any problems. I want this character to have problems. I want him to be a teenager. And the editor's like, what? Not only are you calling him Spider-Man, but you're going to make him a teenager? Yeah, he's going to have trouble with school. He can't keep a job down. He's trying to keep his identity secret from everybody. He's got all kinds of problems. And the editor's like, we're not doing this. Come up with a new idea. So Stan's like, okay, whatever. So he goes home and he says he's been working on this other comic book title called The Amazing Something. And that book wasn't selling well. So they're going to cancel the book. And so there was one last issue. So he decides, I'm going to give Spider-Man a chance. Since it's a book that's going to be canceled anyway, no one's going to care. So instead of calling it The Amazing Whatever, he calls it The Amazing Spider-Man. And he puts that story in there. He doesn't think about it, because the book goes out and it's done. editor comes back. It's like, Stan, this book is selling out. Everybody loves this. You know how that character we both loved, Spider-Man? Let's do more stories about him. So long story short is that Stan and the people at Marvel had done something that hadn't been done a lot in the comic book world, because we have characters like Wonder Woman, we have Superman and other characters like Green Lantern, and they seem to have no problems, no struggles. Even Batman, the most real character of the DC universe, oh, he's a billionaire inventor. Like, gee, tell me about your problems, Playboy billionaire. That doesn't even make sense. So Marvel takes this different direction. They create these characters that have complex problems. They're just trying to maintain relationships or hold on a job while preventing crime. And it ushers in a different era of comics. I share that because, as you can see in the box office, the Marvel properties, the Marvel Cinematic Universe, the MCU, is crushing and destroying box office records. All that is to say, you could be Superman, you could be this perfect person with all the powers in the world, but guess what? No one cares. The most iconic character in the universe, no one cares, because you have no weaknesses, you have no struggles. Your only real weakness, and just imagine if you're asked this question in a job interview, my only weakness is I can't save everyone. Ugh, get out of here. So you need to learn to tell parts of your story. If you want to build an audience, tell your story. Back over to you, Laura.
Yeah, it's that so much of that resonates with me, Chris. And I think our lives would be boring without conflict and struggle, right? Like if our life was just this line, like it would just be boring. Everything would be the same. Even if you were happy all the time, then what would happiness even mean, right? We need the downtimes, the times when we're struggling, in order to really appreciate when things are amazing. And so I think our lives are richer with the challenges and with the conflicts that we have. And so then it's like, what do we do with this? And it's also sometimes running into those challenges instead of running away from them. And that's a big challenge for me. I've always been somebody who kind of ran from conflict. I've never liked it. I was always the people pleaser, the one trying to keep the peace and keep things harmonious. And so, you know, I've had a tendency to run from that conflict, but I've realized, not that it's necessarily easier, but that my life is richer when you can get into the depths of that conflict and those challenges and really see how you can come up on the other side of those things. And you don't always. And sometimes it's going, well, that went to hell, and going, okay, so what new opportunity opened up for me because of that? And so I think it's just being open to what happens in your life. And it's not always about the things that happen. It's about what you then do with it. Who do you become? What do you share? Whose lives do you impact? How does it shift your thinking? That's really what I think that conflict and challenges, they make us richer, much more interesting people than the amazing stories that we can tell. When I think back about my life and living abroad, it was always the travel stories where something went horribly wrong, or the time my boss broke my arm at the Christmas party while we were dancing. You know, like those are the best stories to tell. At the time, they were terrible. But it's not always the shiny, happy trips and the amazing things that are the most interesting stories to tell later on.
Mm. Okay, so what you're saying seems so rational, seems so obvious to me, that why are we having a conversation about this? So let's delve in a little bit in terms of the problems then. So why are we having this conversation? Isn't this what everyone's doing anyways, Laura?
It is not. I see entrepreneurs sabotaging themselves and their businesses all the time in the name of vulnerability and authenticity, but it's them just barfing their trauma and their life onto their audience through their emails, through their social media, on stages. I've witnessed all of these where I actually feel like I'm being like assaulted by what they're sharing, and it's harming me, and it's actually making me like wanna run screaming from the room, so to speak. It reduces my ability to think that you know, would I hire this person? Would I take them seriously? And it's not that I don't care. In fact, sometimes I've realized I actually care too much. And so it can be really hard when we're constantly being bombarded by people oversharing or watching the news, and we're so aware of what's happening all around the world. And it can be really hard for people to take all of that on. I was talking with somebody about this just recently, and she said to me that she had heard that our hearts were only ever meant to hold the trauma and the love and the pain of our village. It was not meant to hold the pain and the trauma and that of the world. And yet every day we're bombarded by that because we are now a global world, because of social media, because of the internet, how we're even communicating right now. It's opened up the world for us in so many ways, but it's also opened up so much of us being kind of traumatized by everything we see and hear. And then it makes it us want to really run away because we can't actually handle experiencing this through what somebody is saying. And further to what you were saying about, you know, the different generations, I think the generations that have always been on social, they just see that as this is just what we do. We just share our lives on social media. So there is a bit of a generational gap, but I think we need to really be teaching younger people that they don't need to lay their souls bare. When they're struggling, that's when you go to your best friend or your partner or your therapist and really get that support. There's a Brené Brown quote that I would love to share from her book, Daring Greatly. I made a note of it. Vulnerability requires boundaries and trust. It's not oversharing. It's not purging. It's not indiscriminate disclosure. It's not celebrity-style social media information dumps. Vulnerability is about sharing our feelings and our experiences with people who have earned the right to hear it. And I absolutely love that quote from her.
I love that too. So you're sharing for the people who have earned the right to hear it. So that means there's an, like you have to identify the audience, meaning I don't want to share all of this with everyone, only the people who I consider as part of my circle. Is that right?
Yeah. I think those are the first people you share with. The first people mm-hmm. you should share when something is happening. If you're in crisis, you share with the people that, you know, are in that inner circle, the people who have earned the right to it. And if later on you feel like the greater audience of you know, your email list or your social media or whatever that might be, they need to hear the story for some reason, whether it's relevance or it can help somebody else, then share it with a broader world. But the first people really should be those people who have earned the right to hear it and that you really trust.
Laura, I want to ask you this question. Do you self-identify as an emotional person or as a logical person or something in between?
Oh my gosh. I'm an interesting mix. I'm a very logical person, and yet I'm also very emotional. So I don't know where I fit
way to
on
straddle
the spectrum.
That fence.
Are those like opposite ends of a spectrum? Because I'm
they
like,
are.
I don't know where. I think because I've been such an emotional person, so I'll share a very vulnerable story. I had insomnia as a kid, like as a teenager, young adult, and back at that time, back in the day, you know, Chris, pre-internet, you know, they struggled to figure out what was wrong with me, right? I remember going to a sleep study and like, why can't Laura sleep? And in hindsight now, and it took me close to 40 years to figure this out, I was taking on the burden of everybody else's problems. I was that friend who everybody came to. I was a great listener. I was great at keeping secrets. And everyone shared with me. And unfortunately, them sharing with me, I took it on as if it were my own problem or challenge. And I would lay awake at night, not able to sleep. And so I think what I learned was to protect myself from that over the years. So I've done a pretty good job of that, but then that sometimes skews me on the logical side. right? Where maybe I care, but if I care too much, then it hurts me. So I'm an interesting mix in that I think my natural predisposition is to be more emotional, but I've trained myself to be more logical.
Wow. At what age
I'm bearing my soul here.
You are. So at what age were you able to make this transition from understanding that I'm really emotional and then now I'm really logical? So how old were you and what are the things you learned that other people who are experiencing too much of emotional on the ends of that spectrum, how do they learn from this and apply a little bit more logic to their emotional being?
You know, I don't know if I have an answer for how old I was. That's a very good question. I feel like it's something I probably built up over the years. I think after my car accident, obviously I was very emotional, but I was also very logical. I was like, I'm going to do everything they told me I'm not going to do. And I also found myself almost trying to comfort the people around me to make them more comfortable with what I was experiencing. So I learned at that time that I really needed to, not share everything. And you know, that this was kind of my journey. And I just sort of forged my own path. And so that was, I guess, probably in my early 20s. And it was closer to when I turned 40 that I started to really understand myself on a deeper level. I really understood how I was affected by other people, by their energy, by the things they said or didn't say, the energy in a room, and really understanding. I'm also an extrovert. I know you're an introvert. I really take on the energy of other people. And I'm like, how did this take me 40 years to really understand? And then I could go back to my childhood and go, oh, that's why I couldn't sleep. So I'm also at this point in my life where I'm trying to find a greater balance between those two things. So I feel more deeply and I still have some of that logic in my life. Although sometimes I'd like to throw logic out the door.
Okay. So somewhere in your 40s, you figured this out, right?
Yeah. I think it was just before my 40th birthday that journey.
So you're able to travel back into the past and sort out, like, using this very logical mind now to go back and kind of decipher and break things apart. It sounds to me, what you've said so far is you're an emotional person, you're empathetic, and you're an extrovert. Those are the three big E's right there.
Yep.
Emotional, empath, and an extrovert. I'm probably the exact opposite. I'm very logical. I'm introverted. And the reason why I asked you this question is I'm setting you up for a question here. The question is this, is that for a person like myself who routinely understands what emotions I'm experiencing and then quickly puts it in a box and says, is this helpful? Is this useful? And if it's not, I kind of just toss it away. And sometimes it's useful, but most oftentimes it's not useful at all. One of my friends, Nidhi, says, what is it? Emotions are not facts. And just because you feel it doesn't make it real. Your feelings are real, but it doesn't make what you're feeling real in the outside world. And so I oftentimes will discount the emotional struggles that I go through because I think it's not that important. And I'm not sharing it because I'm embarrassed or I'm trying to hide it. It didn't register my mind as something that's really important to share. Do you have any advice for someone like me who wants to, who aspires to be as transparent as possible with the good and the bad and everything in between? What do I need to do? What do I need to think about in case there are people in the audience who share how I think of the world?
So I think it's really just making a list of those things that are happening and just acknowledge them. And I do feel a lot, but I also use my logical brain. So similar to you, and like, is the story relevant? Should I share this? And I think it's just sometimes making a list of all of the stories so that you've almost got a catalog and that you could go back to. There was a story that I didn't share for the longest time, and then I was ready to share it. But I didn't know at the time that it was going to be so impactful. So it's often those things that you think, you overthink, should I share this or not? Is this a story that will resonate or not? That are the ones that resonate the most deeply with people. So I would actually challenge your logical brain and go back to that emotion and tap deeper into that, because I think it's like listening to your gut, right? The number of times that I've not listened to my gut and gone ahead with something or signed a client on or said yes to a project or whatever, and it was counter to what my gut was telling me, which you could call your feelings, it always bit me in the butt in the end. And I'm like, oh, I should have just listened to my gut, to what I was feeling. So while feelings may not always be correct or relevant, right? We could be worried about things that, you know, we shouldn't really be worrying about. It's how we're feeling in the moment, but it doesn't mean that it's warranted or real. So I think it's really deciphering what is real and what is, you know, what is not real in this emotion, and testing the waters, testing some of those stories that are come more from a feeling place than a logical place. Or maybe it's actually making a list of like logical stories and feeling stories, and trying to make sure that you interject more of those feeling stories into what you're sharing. That's the logical way to do it.
So this is the emotional person's logical guide to the logical person to tap into their emotions.
Yes, I think so.
There's a lot of coding and decoding that's going on here. And I hope for the people who are tuning in live, you're enjoying this conversation I'm having with Laura. And we're talking about authenticity and vulnerability. I think that probably the most well-known person in this space and vulnerability is Brené Brown. You've mentioned her. I want to ask you another question. But before I do, I want to make sure our audience that are tuning in live have an opportunity to ask you a question or to ask me a question. And so just make sure you ask a very succinct question in the chat. I'll be looking at that. I'm waiting for a question here. So go ahead and say, this question is for Laura and here's my question, or this question is for both of us or for Chris, and then ask it. And then Joan and I will do our best to kind of monitor this. If you don't all hit me with questions at the same time, I will be able to do this while still having a conversation with Laura. And to buy myself a little bit of time, I said I was going to ask you this question and I want to follow up on this, which is, aside from who you already mentioned, Brené Brown, who else is doing a really good job in the public eye of being their whole self, as you mentioned before? Can you give us some examples of people, and then specifically anything you've seen or heard them say or do that is a good case study of like what we should be doing on social media or otherwise or elsewhere?
That's such a good question. And I'm actually not even sure I have an answer for that. I feel like I'm mostly taking note of the people who are not doing as good a job on it than the ones that are doing a really great job. I might have to get back to you on that one.
Okay, that's fine. So you didn't give me a whole lot of time to read the comments.
No, okay. Sorry.
All good.
Keep this going. Do you have anybody? Who do you think?
Well, I'll tell you somebody. I have one person in particular. And maybe what we'll do is I'll say one and then you say one. We'll go back and forth. And if we run out, we run out. In the world of designers, there's a guy. His name is Aaron Draplin. He does a wonderful job of telling his story. And if you want to get a masterclass in storytelling and personal branding, I suggest you watch Aaron Draplin's TED Talk in Portland. It's one of his earlier talks. And it has a lot of views, so you'll know it's him. And the first 10 minutes are just beautifully told. He steps on stage and he's wearing his jean jacket and his shorts and his trucker cap, part of his uniform. He goes, my name is Aaron James Draplin and I'm 40X years old and I'm doing everything I can to make it in the little leagues. And he tells his whole story, you know, I'm doing everything I can to make it in the world of graphic design. And I was watching that and I was like, why do people love Aaron so much? Well, who goes on stage and tells you their middle name? Nobody. Who goes on stage and tells you their age just right off the jump? And so he's saying, I guess you've earned the trust. I'm just going to let you in on my life, my life story. And he tells you story after story. He goes, I tried out for sports. I wasn't good at basketball because I have a 3-inch vertical leap. And he shows a picture of him struggling to play basketball. And he goes on and on and on. So you kind of get the full tapestry of who he is as a person, not just a guy to admire for his design work. And he's done it better than most. Over to you, Laura.
Awesome. Oh, now I want to go watch that TED Talk. That'll be a good one. I haven't seen it. Mm-hmm. So one that I actually just read the book, The Subtle Art of Not Giving a Fill in the Blank. I won't. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm like, I'm not sure I can swear on this, so I will keep this clean. And so I think, you know, Mark Manson, the author, he really is just very authentic in, you know, whether it's through social media or through the book, you really feel like this is really who he is. And he is kind of unapologetic in his authenticity and the vulnerable stories he shares in the book. And you could think, oh, it's very clickbaity in the title, but there's a lot of substance in this book, and it resonated really deeply with me. And he does share some deeply personal stories about his life and the death of a close friend. And it just makes you relate so deeply to him as a human who is writing this book, who's now, like, it's wildly popular. And yes, there's about a gazillion F-bombs in this book. I'd like him to write a kid's version of it, because we started listening to it as like an audiobook with our older son, and we quickly had to turn that off. But like, oh, if only there was a version for teenagers of this book, I think it would be really powerful. But it could be controversial what he's saying, but I found that to be very authentic in the way that he presents himself to the world.
Mm, wonderful. And I have read the book myself. I do like it a lot. And I think there's some F-bombs, probably every other page there's an F-bomb or two, but if strong language doesn't hurt anybody, I think it's fine the way it is for kids to read. I don't think there's anything wrong with using that kind of language. We don't speak like that in the Doe residence, but it's okay. It doesn't hurt my sensibilities if someone else does. So Mark,
it's not about the F-bombs. Yeah. It's more about some of the context. We're like, but you know, we listen to all kinds of music.
I'll have to reread it.
Yeah. We don't filter music in our house, because I remember growing up with the music being very censored. And I distinctly remember that backfiring very poorly. So I'm like, you know what? There's lots of good music with, you know, with swearing in it. And I'm not going to censor it just because that's in the song.
Yeah. So I have to reread it, because I didn't read it with the lens of a parent. So I was like, oh, that's all fine. There's nothing crazy in here. There's some sex, drug, and rock and roll kind of things in there. But, you know, I bet the kids can see much worse today on the just typing on Google. Right?
Oh, yes.
Let's not go there, though.
Let's not go there.
Yeah. I have your first question, though. Okay. So this question is from Thomas O'Neill. He's watching right now. His question is this: as a beginner in the user experience industry trying to break into my first job, should I practice keeping my emotions at a minimum? Will this hurt my chances?
Thanks for the question, Thomas. I think we need to have emotion. People need to connect with you, whether you're trying to get a job or you're trying to get clients to hire you. Either way, it's about connection, and you can't build connection without emotion. It doesn't mean you should be coming in there as like an emotional mess, but I think really showing that you care, really showing that you've put the effort into, you know, learning about this potential job or this potential client, whatever that is, and trying to build that deeper connection, you do that through emotion. You don't do that through logic, right? It's about creating a heart-to-heart connection with people, and that is really done through emotion.
All right. Thank you very much for... Yeah, absolutely. So I want to share something else, because sometimes people are always curious about how to create content on social media. I found this. I would spend a lot of time creating this graphic. I thought, oh, this is a beautiful graphic. I'm going to use all the tricks I learned in school about graphic design. I'm going to create this emblem or symbol, and it's rich with metaphor. It's going to be this thing. People are going to love this thing. And then I post it. And it's like crickets out there. Like, nobody cares. Why is that? Well, there's a couple of reasons. One is I'm sharing an idea. So the idea transcends me. There's nothing in it about me. There's no point of view. And there's nothing about how I interpret this idea and why I'm sharing it in the first place. So you talked about this a lot before, about why do you share anything? What's your intention? My intention, generally speaking, is to help people and to be a good teacher. So I probably don't observe all the rules that you do, Laura, in terms of sharing other people's stories, because I'm not always that concerned about people getting hurt. I don't go out of my way to hurt anybody, but I will say what needs to be said in my mind because I think it drives the lesson home. So I always choose, if necessary, to err on the side of the lesson versus like making sure everybody's feelings are okay. It does get me into hot water from time to time. I don't recommend it for everybody, especially if you have a job that you can't afford to lose. But I did find this, that in terms of a general formula for people to share content, if you tell a personal story that elicits an emotional reaction that has a clear takeaway, you'll do really well in life in terms of like how that will perform. So let's break that down because it's a very simple statement. Let me say it one more time. Tell a personal story that elicits an emotional reaction that has a clear takeaway, like a point. So the personal story has to do with something with you. You have to contextualize the lesson from your life. Something you saw, something you've experienced. And we see a lot of people, what they do is they regurgitate information or even other people's stories. Nothing wrong with that. But until you start to tell your story, it'll be about you retelling other people's stories. And so if there's something that happened to you, something that you've experienced, like I've shared the story before about how I was negotiating with my son, who at that time I think was only, I think he was like 8 or 9 years old. And he wanted me to design a logo for him. And he didn't want to pay me. And I was like, wait a minute. And so I tell this story, right? And I've told this story before. I won't tell you the story today. And then when I tell this story, it's a father-son dynamic. There's a parenting lesson. There's a negotiation lesson. And about whether or not these negotiation tricks, quote unquote, that I use, work with people or not. And I'll jump to the end. Spoiler alert, it works on all ages, by the way. And so people who have heard the story, who've read the story, they get worked up. They are like, you go, what a way to raise a child. Or they're like, how could you do that to your son? They have an emotional reaction to this. And these stories tend to be the ones that stick. Eric Admetus says this. He says, stories are the operating system of the human brain, the human mind. If you don't tell a story that is an emotion, it's not going to be memorable. People are going to forget it. So as a logical, cold-blooded alien robot, I do understand the need to connect emotionally with people. So I pretend to have emotions that I write about them. Over to you, Laura.
I think it's important to share, those challenges. Like you said, it's, you know, that the stories that, with your son, I think it's so important to share these, whether or not you think people are going to agree with you. I think those are actually, they can be the scariest stories to share, but yet they're probably the most important ones to share because it will make people feel something, right? Like people want to feel something, whether they are pissed off at you or they're like, yes, and they totally agree with you. Either way, you're creating an emotional reaction. They're feeling something. And we want to be able to evoke those kinds of emotions. If you're trying to placate people or you're just trying to play it safe, you're going to get a lot less reaction, positive or negative, because it's a bit wishy-washy. And so I think it is important to share these real stories and get people agreeing or disagreeing with you. A number of years ago, I can't remember when it was exactly, I shared an opinion piece on my blog about how I feel about the term mompreneur. Long story short, I despise the term mompreneur. That's the spoiler alert. And I was so nervous sharing this blog post because I was in some groups that women identify as mompreneurs. And I just felt so deeply and viscerally about this word and this term. And I was like, I have to share this opinion. And I still remember like hitting send on that email out to my email list and sharing it publicly and feeling like, oh my God, this is going to either go really well or really poorly or maybe both. And it was actually really fascinating, the response I got. And it actually prompted a group that I was in to change the way they described the group. They actually removed the word mompreneur from the description. I was like, wow, I made that change because I wasn't afraid to share my opinion on something. And I actually had so many other women entrepreneurs that are mothers as well that also feel the same way. But if I had not shared that story and my opinion, you know, no change might have happened. So I think we have to share those opinions. We have to be willing to be somewhat controversial and stand up for something we believe in. That is how we disrupt things. That is how change is made.
That's right. If everybody falls in love with your opinion, I'd argue that you don't have an opinion. You just have something that makes everyone happy. And that's just these empty platitudes that people say all the time. I have another question for you. Okay, right. So we have another question coming in. But before I get into that question, I want everyone to think of it like this, okay? And this is, I saw this in a video, I forget who it was, so I can cite who I heard it from. But I want you to imagine that you're driving on a freeway and there's like five lanes. It's like the 405 freeway here in LA, okay? It's five lanes, so it's really wide. The center three lanes are the lanes of apathy and indifference. So your idea travels like the car. And if you have an opinion that no one cares about, that doesn't wake anyone up, that's just that you're stuck in that middle area of apathy and indifference. What you want to do is you want to pull to the left or to the right to find out what you believe in and to be able to say that and to run the risk of alienating some people. There's another expression that I love is it's something like this. I hold strong opinions loosely or weakly, meaning I have a strong opinion. And I think in Laura's example, she gave a strong opinion, but she was also like, oh, this could backfire. So what that says to me is I have a strong opinion, and depending on how I state it or if I've been thoughtful enough in articulating this idea, if I'm wrong, I will have a new opinion. And that's the beautiful thing about opinions. You can have a new one tomorrow. So the idea is to have strong opinions, but be amenable to hearing other people and to have the courage to be able to say, I changed my mind. I was wrong. I stand corrected. Okay, here's the new question that's coming in. And then I think we're going to start to wrap up here. Okay, Laura? So
All right. This
question comes in from Maestro Stevens. I don't believe Maestro is his first name, but this is internet name. Maestro Stevens is asking both of us this question, but I'm going to direct it to you. How do you get past feeling less valuable than your competition if you offer similar value but don't show your lifestyle or behind the scenes for personal reasons? How do you still earn trust? So he sounds like he wants to be able to share parts of his vulnerability, but he has personal reasons, whatever that might be, for why he can't. How can you still earn trust?
Well, I think it depends on the stories. I mean, it doesn't mean you have to share stories about your kids, or like a lot of people don't want to show pictures of their kids on their social media, or their spouse doesn't want to be on camera. And so they're like, I can't share parts of my personal life. But you can share more of you. Who are you? What are you challenged with? Who are you as a real person that doesn't necessarily include, you know, perhaps your family? I'm making assumptions that that's why you can't share that part of your life. But the best way to build trust with people is for them to know who you are. The number of clients that hire us and they say, I just know I have to work with you because of how I make them feel, and that trust that they feel because of how I present myself on social media, on our website, you know? And so I think if you're always holding back, and like Chris was saying, you know, you can create the most beautiful carousel on something or this like amazing post to put on social media, but nobody likes it. But then you share a personal story, and I've experienced this many times where you put hours of effort into creating some content for social media, then you put a personal photo of you up and it gets more likes and more shares and more comments than anything than that you've just, you know, that you're like, but that's not what I'm selling. This is, but the reality is you're selling you. You are the brand and you need people to relate to you in some way. So I would recommend finding some stories you can share about yourself that you feel comfortable sharing if there are other people that you cannot share their stories. I hope that helps, Maestro Steve.
Maestro, I hope we've played that well. Okay, sorry. Every character, every superhero needs an origin story. If you pay attention to a lot of the comic book adaptations, they always have this really intriguing origin story, and there's a reason why. Simon Sinek talks about this. He says, we trust people who believe what we believe. He goes on to share this example that sometimes gets missed when people are quoting him or referencing this famous talk that he delivered. He says, I'll put it to the test, okay? He's like, what's the most valuable thing, the resource that you have right now? And people yelled out a bunch of different things. He goes, your children, right? That's what you said? It doesn't always come to mind when you're asking about your most valuable resource or asset. It's your children. And he goes, you would do anything for your children. And many parents live for their children. And so you would think that this is a big and important decision when you want to go out on a night on the town with your spouse, and you're going to leave and trust the safety and welfare of your children to someone. He goes, well, let me present to you two scenarios. One is a 16-year-old girl, Sally, and she grew up in the neighborhood. You've known her all her life, and you know her parents, and you get a sense of values, right? So that's one. And then you have a professional British nanny who's been trained, who's certified, who's been working for 35 plus years. He says, which one are you more likely to entrust with the welfare of your children or your child? And then he's like, exactly. So you would actually trust a 16-year-old teenager more so than a professionally trained British nanny. And why is that? Because you don't know her story. You don't know what her values and beliefs are. How is she going to respond to certain situations? Logically, you should have picked the professional versus the teenager, because the teenager is going through their own emotional arc, and they have their own interests, and they might not always do what is right for your child. And that's the power of this emotional brain that we have, how we make decisions emotionally. So if you want people to trust you, to hire you, to care about you, to root for you, to buy your course or your book, or to show up when you speak, you got to tell your origin story. It's part of the whole creation mythology. People see you today as being successful, but they want to know how you got there. And the reason why they want to know that is not only to know what your beliefs and values are, but they also want to say, well, how do I become like you? What steps did you go through? What struggles have you had? What critical decisions did you make that, had you gone left instead of right, your life would have turned out differently? So they can map their own story to yours. That's really what people are doing. So when you're a good storyteller, they're putting themselves inside the story, and they're feeling what you felt. They're seeing what you saw, and they're hearing what you heard. And this is really important. Laura, I know we've been talking for some time here, but I just wanted to make sure if there was anything else that you thought was relevant so that we can complete this thought.
I think we've covered so much, and I love what you just shared, because it really is important to share those origin stories. And I've really put a lot of effort into doing that through my blog and the things that I share. You know, I pivoted my business. I know everyone's tired of the word pivot. Almost 6 years ago, I went through, like, we'll call it an existential crisis. And I was trying to figure out, like, who am I? What am I doing? Where am I going? And it took a while, but I figured it out, and I forged this new path, and it was bumpy, and it was ugly at times, and beautiful, and all the things. And I shared that journey to show people, like, it takes courage, and it takes really listening to yourself and really deciding what it is that you want for your life. You know, lately I've been thinking about this concept of, you know, what are we dying for? But not in the sense of, like, that immediacy, but, like, we're dying every day. Like, we will die one day. That is a fact that is happening in our life. So what are we trading our life for? And really truly living. And so that's been something that's really been coming up for me. And I share that because we've got to go through those things. It's all about the courage to not just live in that complacency or that those middle lanes, as you said, can't remember the words you used, but, like, you've really got to find that path for yourself so that you're not just going through the motions of existing. And that requires pushing yourself outside of your comfort zone, and growth does not come in comfort. I've definitely learned that. And so not that you always want to be in discomfort, but it's really learning what you can do and grow from that. And then when you're ready, sharing that journey, because that origin story, that story of how you shifted, how something big happened, and not everything went the way it was supposed to, right? But just showing that journey really helps people see you and relate to you in a much more powerful way.
Thank you for sharing this with me. And I'm so glad we got to connect again. And I'm also thrilled that you've embraced the title and are owning Brand Strategist. Laura, thank you very much for joining us today on the live stream. If people want to find out more about you and get in contact with you and what you do, where's the best place for them to do this?
Yeah, you can check out our website, which is labcreative.ca. I can always post this in the chat. I think Maria, who's part of my team, is here. She can share that. We're on Instagram. Lab Creative Inc. Is our handle across all of the channels. I do have my book, Brand Chemistry, I can't reach it. It's over my shoulder. Is available on Amazon if anybody wants to buy my book.
Wonderful. So it's labcreative.ca because she's in Canada. She's in Toronto. So that's how you remember it, labcreative.ca. Yep. Thank you very much, Laura. And I'm going to say goodbye and thank everybody for tuning in. Jonah, thanks for cutting this episode. Play a little bit of music here. And I just want to let everybody know, we're going to be coming back with a whiteboard session. Don't miss this. A whiteboard session, yes. And I hope you're not annoyed by all these shorts that we're cutting and sharing with you, but they're the most popular things that we make. So we got to do what the algorithm wants. Until next time, everybody, have an amazing day.